Hello, interwebs. I'm dancing for no reason. This is F3G2. I'm some dork you don't really know. There's another dork behind the camera, but he's bigger than me. But he's sexy anyway.
So much sexy.
I'm going to review some comical books for you. Starting with Chewbacca.
Brr.
He's big, he's hairy.
Probably related to him.
He may very well be related to. You need like a bandolier for your camera. So
I kind of got that with
Chewbacca. Has to get past his post-traumatic stress disorder of slavery and claustrophobia in order to help save the day, and he does. This book, it's Jerry Duggan, so it's good to read. It's Phil Noto, so it's beautiful to look at. This is a good comical book. Batgirl 45. Don't go breaking my heart. Tough you, you're a dick. Literally, you're Dick Grayson. Alright, so Barbara Gordon is an even better bridesmaid, maid of honor, than she is a superhero. Also, she, there's only one flaw I had with this book. She sort of throws Dick Grayson aside for Luke Fox. I don't really have a problem with that, because there's always the will they won't they with Babs and Grayson, and the New 52 has kind of messed it up. And this shift has made her, I realize she's in college, but somehow in this she seems like so much younger than Dick, even though apparently she's older than him, because he was like a young Robin when he had his crush on her. She was older. I don't really know.
Headaches.
Yes, I try not to think too much about the fact that clearly no one communicates. But in that lack of communication, the one flaw that I really had with this is Dick seems to have no idea who Luke Fox is. I'm like, oh, if you're anything like your father, you're a good guy. I'm like, no. Wait, you were still Nightwing when he was... Luke Fox was Batwing. You know this guy. No, you're not allowed... Aquaman 45 was really good. Aquaman's on another planet because his teleportation doesn't work like it should.
Aquaman can teleport?
Well, he got his trident boosted from, Poseidon.
Well, that'll do it.
The big, kind of whale-looking, Leviathan-looking Wonder Woman version of...
God of the Sea.
Yeah, the God of the Sea. Multiversity Deluxe Edition. Looks really expensive, but it's got a Charlton Heroes world. Anyway, blah, 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 blah. Aquaman. On this other world, the people there seem to connect to Earth and the other dimension where all the trouble is coming from. Aquaman's bleeding out. He knows he's got to go save his wife, that she's been replaced by her sister. He's got that secret information. But on this other world, everybody seems to be listening to him. He's like, oh, that's cool. Until he finds out that the reason they're listening to him is they have a giant globe. And there it was, Earth, the way it was before the fall of Atlantis. You know, the continents are shaped differently. And there I am, standing upon it like a conqueror. So, apparently, these aliens are ready to be Aquaman's army.
Emperor Aquaman
and
shall return.
He's like, Cyborg number 4. Good, not as good as it's been up till now. Part of that is the lack of Ivan Reis on the inside. Part of it was just... It got a little muddy, both art and story-wise. So it's still good. Not the great, pristine thing of beauty that it has been. Cyborg number 4. The Dark Side War. Batman. One shot. Batman has the chair of things. And he goes with it to Gotham. And he's a dick. Turns out it's the chair more than... Metron. Apparently everyone who sits in the chair becomes a dick. And Batman keeps getting a nosebleed because the chair's like, we're supposed to do this. And Batman's like, fuck you. I'm Batman. I do what I want. And the chair's like, son of a bitch. Including most of the issue, Batman uses it to fuck with Joe Chill. He literally just goes into his prison cell, takes him to the alley, you know, gets a confession of stuff he already knows, because he knows everything thanks to the chair. He's like, you know, you killed the Waynes. Like, yeah, I killed the Waynes. I killed like 40 people. He's like, I know you did. You ever feel bad about it? He's like, nah. He's like, Bob's probably that kid's boogeyman. He probably won't. He's like, oh, you were. I mean, takes off the mask, shows him who he is, threatens the crap out of him, scares the crap out of him, and then tells him, how long do you think you'll last in prison if I start a whisper here, a whisper there, so that everyone on death row, everyone in prison knows Joe Chill created the Batman? And he's like, no. And then Batman's like, fuck it. Forget it. You don't remember any of this. But he remembers enough to still wake up terrified. And he's scared of the Batman now and isn't sure why. So that was kind of cool. And now it's building towards, I know this is a one shot, but it builds towards, you know, he's looking, he's like, you know, now I know enough. Says, our mission can finally be completed. An absolute Batman dealing absolute justice. And thanks to the chair, I'll be able to narrow my focus from the many to the one. Because he says now he knows who Joker is. He's going to go and deal with Joker. Weird, though, because some of these are scenes from, you know, pre-New 52 Bat things, obviously. You know, Killing must Joke. Be cool to get to redraw things from The Killing Joke and things from and that classic. Like, that's from the Best of the Joker hardcover. But then some of these are clearly covers from, you know, redrawings of covers from the current, you know. This story didn't even take, if he's still Bruce, this story can't have happened yet. So, meh. Meh. Time?
Yeah.
Continuity?
Continuity.
Fuck you. DC does not stand for direct continuity.
No. Not when the chair's involved.
Superman Injustice. How do I put this?
Meh.
Yeah. It's that, the hell is his first name? Oh, you're going to be a back? Oh, well, credits on you. Yep. Gene Luen Yang is the writer, and Howard Porter is the artist. So it looks, oddly enough, because of the way some of this is done, Howard Porter is the main artist on Justice League 3000, now Justice League 3001. Superman isn't dressing like Superman anymore because, you know, whatever. Probably it starts to look like a lot. It just looked like there were times where I kept forgetting, oh shit, no, this is the real Clark. This isn't JL3K. But basically, Superman joins Mythological Fight Club. There's a fight club for like fallen South American pantheons. And they were gods. They're not really worshipped anymore. They've lost most of their ability. They fight. And Superman joins it because he's looking for information. So now,
sure. There's
like his Latin American deities in like luchador. One of them's in a luchador mask. The rest of them are sort of not. In like a super powered god fight club.
Sounds cool.
And yet, it's not. It doesn't sound cool at all. It sounds
ultimately, sounds out of place.
Yeah, it sounds like, you know, tell me again how, man, Superman, with all of his powers, it's really hard to write. He's a tough character to get a feel on, so we need to make some tweakages so that we can make stories that are interesting that people want to read. So what have we come up with? What about a South American deity fight club where Superman can fight depowered gods? Oh shit, we're going with that. It's been approved by editorial. We're going with that. So that was a meeting that happened.
It sounds cool, just not for Superman.
It would make a great indie comic if you eliminated the depowered Superman and just made a deity fight club. Yes.
That would be fantastic.
But this is like spread. The flying things. Act like not the flying things. So good. So worth the wait. This book is a little less than timely. Next issue. Crazy Molly's origin. Hard to imagine not being crazy in this particular time frame. But one of the bad guys turned, let's go with anti-hero, is of course the cannibalistic version of our own cameraman. And his origin will be the issue after the next issue. So Jack's origin comes in issue, what's this? This is issue 11, so Jack will be 13, Crazy Molly's 11. Crazy post-apocalyptic mutant monster. Not quite zombie. It's more like
infected.
Take a little bit of Mad Max. Don't go too far over the top, Mad Max. Just a little bit of Mad Maxian. And mix that with a little bit of like Walking Dead feel. But instead of zombies, let's go with I know. Let's go with John Carpenter's The Thing. Mix well. Voila. Damn. Oh, and just for fun, let's make our hero a man called No, who mostly says no, and has just a dash of... What if Samurai Jack was a homeless man? There. That's my description. And if you're not reading it now, I don't know what's wrong with you.
Technically, he was during the show.
Well, yeah. Justice League 3001, Predator or Prey, Batman versus Batman, who the hell's this Batman? I don't know. Alright, so, we already found out that Earth has been turned into Tangron Galdos, a prison colony, a prison planet. When Blue Beetle and Booster Gold showed up, they found a fat guy calling himself Blue Beetle running around who'd found a stash of Blue Beetle stuff, rigged it up to work, and wow, that got weirdly quiet once that fan died for the AC. So Blue Beetle had found the new Blue Beetle, and they had everything. Now, turns out there are many Batmen, and this one is this big armored thing, and I'm thinking we're going to get Robin 3001, because when they open it up, there's a teenage girl in there who refuses to believe that the new, what do you call it? The new,
that
the reincarnated Bruce could possibly be the real Bruce, because he seems basically too much of a pussy to have been the Bruce Wayne of legend. Plus Bruce finds out from Supergirl, who is the pre-New 52 actual Supergirl. He's like, my parents really died? I thought that was just a legend. They were really killed like that? He has no, you know, he didn't know that was really the origin. Guy is getting memories because the body of a woman, but he's, turns out, a bargain basement version of the reincarnation process. So they don't do it, the wipe isn't as complete, and he gets residual memories from the person whose body the DNA was rewritten. Oops. So we may lose Guy altogether, or get some kind of amalgamation of part Guy, part this woman, who apparently has a family and whatever, even though they claim she volunteered for this process. Savage Dragon 208. I'm
about to say, that's been much.
Violence, death, more death, good guys die, bad guys die, cloning happens, you know, and Toadie has the last laugh, because, you know, why not? Also, Dragon's getting ready to get married, and there's still the disaster of can his fiance have the baby without dying, and, either way,
still got the other two to worry about.
Can she have it? And, can she have it not die? And the person who is supposed to come up with a way for her to not die is one of the people that dies this issue. Oops. Captain America, Sam Wilson. I love this. Yeah, it's been all over Fox News because, oh no, Cap versus the right wing, you know. But yeah, fuck it. Don't like it? Suck it. It's just a jump to the left. We find out what the falling out is, and it's not really as big a schism as one would have you feel, as the cover would imply. And Cap seems to be a little proud, with a little knowing proud smirk of Sam taking his own direction. But, yeah, Sam, he tries, he makes mistakes. I love the way this issue is laid out, where it's a series of flashbacks within flashbacks to, you know, him traveling on the plane and Misty kind of telling him off. The next issue, the return. Look, it's going to be a Sam Wilson Cap Wolf. I'm dying here. Robin, son of the Batman. Game changer. Talia's back. She's not so dead anymore. Turns out all the stuff he's been that Damian has been undoing from his year of blood has been involved returning artifacts that were supposed to be gathered because people even more evil than the Al Ghuls used to be in charge of the Lazarus Pits and now are coming back from the dead because Damian unwittingly helped out with that.
Oops.
Nobody even saves Damien's life after still talking throughout the issue of her plans to, after everything is set right, she still wants to kill him, but she saves his life. They're starting to, an unwitting little, you know, against all odds team. And yeah, in the end, you've got Ravi, Talia, Nobody, Damien, and Goliath as his last little holdout. Next issue, Atonement. I think they're going to see the movie. We are Robin. Robin's on a Batman. No, we are Robin. Robin's on a Batman. No, we are. Anyway, I really like the art on this issue. Who's the art? Jorge Corona is the art on this, which is a change up from previously. I don't know if this is starting to lead towards the Robin, you know, the Robin War, the War of the Robins, whatever it is. But these Robins run across what's that big Talon's name? One of the major, they say his name somewhere. El Topo, one of the big Talons from the Court of Owls, and they're starting their thing, and, you know, of course, owls are birds of prey, and robins are not so much. So, that's going on. We have some family issues. I love the various takes on the Robin costume. This one girl ends up really looking like Jubilee, but Jubilee was supposed to be dressed like a, you know, a nod to Robin, so it all comes full circle. But We Are Robin, really, really good book. They also make an appearance in Batman Eternal, but that's in there somewhere. Spidey 2099. If you're a Spider-Man, you learn that great power comes with great responsibility, and you normally learn that from the death of someone. If you're Miguel, you learn that with great power comes great fucking need for revenge, and you learn that from the death of someone you love, because Miguel is not Peter. And that's pretty much what goes down. What's it take to get him in the suit he said he'd never wear? The death of Tempest and
Vengeance.
Yeah, he's got, look, the old suit's still there, so we could see it again. I don't understand, in comic terms, they don't always do a great job of explaining this. When you update these things and do this cool stuff to your suits that's capable, like Peter made this suit for Miguel. It's the material is made of unstable molecules bonded with Kevlar, increasing its durability so that nothing short of a howitzer can penetrate it. Lightbite material better integrated to improve gliding, and internal boot thrusters for launch. Spider sources running down the sleeves integrated into the gloves, providing distance offensive capabilities. Onboard sensors for complete vicinity reading, state-of-the-art top to bottom. So why isn't all of that gear in Peter's suit? Ain't nobody knows. I know his new suit does new things, But, you know, why do you make that? You know,
maybe Miles' physiology is better adapted to it. He does have slight differences.
It's like if you're an Avenger without powers, and you're on a team with Tony Stark, why is he not built armor for all the non-powered Avengers? All right, I'm going to wear this state-of-the-art armor. We're going to work with a god and a guy with this serum in him that makes him like the peak of humanity and a monster that gets super strong, and you can have a bow and arrow.
And you have guns and stunners.
There's a modified suit you could give them, you know, something.
I mean, but you did have Iron Widow on
the Sinestro 16. Awesome, 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 and awesome. The ultimate pairing again. Sinestro comes to Earth to find out some secrets that only one man knows. Black Adam. So, Sinestro and Black Adam team up, and in case that's not a good enough team up, for part of the book, it's once again drawn by Ethan Van Sciver. So, Ethan Van Sciver drawing Sinestro and Black Adam.
Happy.
Why are you not just reading this now? New Avengers. I like this book. So I get people that don't. I want Sunspot to take more of an active Avengery role, because while he gets to be the, you know, billionaire backer, head of the corporation, organizing guy, and that's a good role for him, he is also a superpowered mutant and should be, you know, who's some serious muscle that, you know, that the team could use from time to time. Although, I suppose he is a tad redundant on a team with Hulkling and Power Man, but still, the more the merrier, right? Plus, I love Sunspot. What really breaks my heart is, why is Cannonball not on this team?
Because you like him.
Well, he was an Avenger with Sunspot, and now Sunspot's got his own Avengers, and Cannonball's not on it? But we get, you know, some other dimensionally goodness. We've still got the Maker, evil Reed Richards, in the background. And the art's still not my favorite. Everybody still has that sad, angry look, even when they shouldn't be. But, I can survive that for whatever. Squirrel Girl, who's on those Avengers. See, look, there they are. The bravest thing about this book is it wasn't just a hee-hee there in the background. No, Koi Boy and Chipmunk Hunk are actually ongoing supporting their actual superheroes. I so want them on a new team of New Warriors. We meet Squirrel Girl's mom, who is exactly how you would picture Squirrel Girl's mom. We don't meet Squirrel Girl's dad. Some part of me is terrified to think that when we do meet him, he's going to be a squirrel.
I'm thinking something along the lines of Miyazaki with the raccoons.
But don't go with those Miyazaki raccoons. We get to see young Squirrel Girl in flashbacks. And, you know, at some point you're going to be able to order through previews the pink shirt that the mother wears that says on it, "I've squirreled away a place in my heart for Squirrel Girl." Look for that in previews.
Your book got hurt.
New Suicide... Oh, my Suicide Squad book got folded in. What? Oh, yeah, it's a Suicide Squad. And they're in for a world of more hurt. We've started the adventures of Amanda Waller is back in the field. I still miss... they can do so much more with her, I get it, but I miss my 5 foot nothing, no matter what way you turn her, Amanda Wall. I want Amanda Wall to be the wall. I want that woman who, through sheer girth and attitude, stares down Batman and Superman and psychopaths and is not afraid. This one may be, you know, she may be badass, but she doesn't, you know, there's nothing.
Nana was the wall.
Yeah, I miss the wall. You know, she's a brick. Anywho, they kind of go AWOL, and it ends with suspense as Amanda doesn't have a device in her head because she's not actually part of it. But this face, Sage, Vic Sage, ends the issue with his hitting click on a button that says terminate all to blow the devices in the heads of Parasite, Harley Quinn, Deadshot, and Captain Boomerang. So, that could end. And they're not blowing up those characters. Maybe Parasite, but you know they ain't killing any of those others. Howling Commandos of S.H.I.E.L.D. number one makes me happy. Although, the werewolf guy needs to get taken down a peg.
Ultimate verse Howling Commandos?
No, this is...
The Monsters.
Yeah. But this is all in the right here, right now. You've got... It's led by the robot version. What is it? The life model decoy of...
Dum-Dum.
Dum-Dum Dugan. And his team consists of... Orgo. Who's actually like tech support back at the whatever.
Man-Thing?
Man-Thing. Man-Phibian. Hit-Monkey. There's one werewolf guy.
Werewolf by Night?
No. One of my favorite new characters. Teen Abomination. She's called Vampire by Night. That's... Agent Sitwell as a zombie that's also just a complete and total dumbass zombie and does more damage to our team than he does to anything else. But what the hell is that one guy? Reyna. Reyna is the werewolf who considers it his team and not Dugan's because he considers Dugan not Dugan. Zombie Jasper Sitwell, Manphibian, Vampire by Night, Orgo, Man-Thing, Hit-Monkey, and Teen Abomination. My strike team. Let's remember the chain of command. Whatever you say, Reyna. So Reyna thinks he's the big bad. The Spire returns and gets all sorts of Game of Thronesy.
Damn, I've got to catch up.
Continues to be so good. And it's fun to realize that The Spire is written by Simon Spurrier. So Simon Spurrier, Spire, with art by Jeff Stokely. Simon Spurrier, Spire, Stokely. That's fun to say. What issue was this? This was issue number four? This is four. That's as far as we got. Bad things on the horizon. It's like... I can add a new name to the mix. I always refer to this as... Mobius... What if Mobius had done... Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. So it's like Mobius Game of Thrones. But art-wise, it goes between being like Mobius with a touch of, you know, anime, and there's always a feel of, what's his name that I really like? Is it Paul Grist? Is he the guy that does Jack Staff and Mudman and all the... So those kind of feels... Really, really good. Gets all sorts of political intrigue, turning in on itself. Very intrigue, espionage-y in this fantasy world where, as everybody else is playing this like political game, there's other people coming up and going, well, we're just going to fucking invade and we don't care what your inner politics are. So, you know, Book of Death has death, including the death of someone who shouldn't have any death because he should be eternal. And the cover's shiny and almost has a 3D effect that I really like. There is a teaser in the back for Wrath of the Eternal Warrior, so I guess he's not as dead as one would think when he dies. Or that takes place before. By the way, this gives us a nice sense of closure for this story while still leaving the potential of Springboard off. Oh, this was one of the best books of this week. Greg Rucka and Nicholas Scott's Black Magic number one. Gorgeous, Black and white and gray all over with dabs of color when they want it, just to draw the eye and set an attention and set a mood. Really strikingly well done. I mean, Nicola Scott is Nicola Scott, so her art will always be gorgeous. And I love the opening. It starts, you know, could be any time period, set to look older. There's a coven of witches performing their sacred rituals. You get, you know, a little bit of the nudities. And then somebody's cell phone goes off, and they get mad, and it brings you, you know, smack into the reality of it's today, and the one member is like, you know, I gotta go, that was work, because that is, in fact, this Detective Black, who has been called in specifically because there's this lunatic looking for her, and this sets the whole tone of, you know, even if you're a cop witch, you're still a witch. What do people like to do with witches? They like to try and burn them. So, there's, you know, you've got, like, Law and Order meets Supernatural. As written by Greg Rucka and as drawn by Nicola Scott, it's beautiful. And the story is dark in, it's not dark like, oh, so heavy or whatever, but it's, you know, it's clearly got that very serious and somber tone, and the grays, the grayscale that it's done in really plays up that scale. And then, like I said, there's, you know, certain things are emphasized, and I'm colorblind, so, you know, when you play with color, sometimes that doesn't always work for me, because sometimes I don't know. But even without knowing 100% what the colors are that are used, you know, the candles all have color to them and are lit. Everything else is gray. You know, the cell phone being colored in, on one hand, could just be a lettering choice, but on the other hand, makes it really stand out as so out of place, just like the phone does. We get our crazy guy, we get a close-up, and even in black and white, his eyes are bloodshot and red. When she uses power later, you know, it manifests in her eyes and in the you know, and in fire around. So the focal point, much like in certain practicing of magic, there's a focal point. The focal point is there and made for you in color. It was a beautiful book, well written. It's really, this is like this whole thing. Yeah, while the book has a cold open, just like a TV show would, really this whole issue could be considered a cold open for us. This is all, you know, things are actually happening, but at the same time we're really being introduced to the world and the characters, and I think it's really well done. Really, really well done. Batman and Robin number 4, Batman and Robin Eternal number 4, which, you know, I mentioned earlier. All the other Robins show up, and our Robins seem okay with that. Which on the one hand, I don't know. I mean, I get it, but it seems like the kind of thing that ordinarily they would, you know, we don't want a whole group of untrained kids out there doing whatever. Especially since it really seems like the last thing Alfred would drag children into, but he's doing it, so whatever. Anywho, this continues to be good. I'm waiting to see more of how this goes on. We get some, what's been great about this is there's some great interaction between a whole lot of different people that, some of whom we haven't seen interact in a while, some of whom we haven't seen interact ever, and some of whom we haven't seen these versions interact. And it's just fun to really just, boom, they're really just mixing it up, as opposed to the original Batman and Robin, Batman Eternal, where it was still really, really good, but you'd have a whole issue focus on these two, and a whole issue focus on this one, and a whole issue focus here. But this is like, you know, and toss it all together. Grayson 13, even though I like him getting back into the world over here, and I would love to see him back as Nightwing, there's some great stuff happening in Grayson, and it would almost be sad to see that go. They keep pulling in and playing on the new connection of the mightiest dynamic duo, which is Dick Grayson and Midnighter. They introduce a new version of Ladytron, and from what it looks like in the shadows, Grifter may be hanging out in the shadows. Some cool stuff going on in here. Venture number 3 from Action Lab. This is written by Jay Farber and drawn by Jamal Igle. So, two of my favorites. The colorist's name is Sebastian. Sebastian. You know, he's got the little whatever. Lemon Rand. But, you know, we Sebastians. Doesn't matter how you want to spell it. We're good. And a letter at Ray Dillon. This is the guy with superpowers who didn't really want to be a hero. And seems to be quite long-lived. But he's basically blackmailed into being a superhero by someone who wants to get famous for reporting on it. Things go wrong. Things get heated. Really well done. Great take on the concept of the almighty Superman type guy. Only this time he's really just wanted to live in the background, and he's forced out. He doesn't like it, but he does the right thing at any cost, which still makes him right now more Superman than Superman. And like I said, we all know, I read everything that Jay Farber puts out, and, you know, Jamal Igle is Jamal Igle, so what's to not love there? Finally, Black Hood number 6, Flor de Muerto, written by Straczynski and drawn by Howard Chaykin. Which at first I didn't realize that it was drawn by him, and I was like, wow, this guy's got a very Howard Chaykin feel. And then it turns out it's because he has a real Howard Chaykin feel. He's Howard Chaykin. This is why you should look at covers before you start reading. Someone plays upon both our boy's killer instincts and his protect and serve instincts, and ends up accidentally making him a mob hitman. Who knew?
Oops.
Yeah, things like that happen. You go to rehab to get better, and you end up a mob enforcer. Shit happens. All right, that's the show for this week. Go, be free, fly, little birds.
Thanks for watching another video from Gunna Geek. If you like Geeky Stuff, check out our podcast network, our news and articles, and our community forums. You can find it all at GunnaGeek.com, like us at Facebook.com/GunnaGeek, tweet us at GunnaGeek, subscribe to our YouTube channel at YouTube.com/GunnaGeek, and check out our live programming at GunnaGeek.com/live.